Welcome back to BOGO Biology. In this video, we'll be discussing how C3, C4, and CAM plants perform photosynthesis, avoid performing the wasteful process of photorespiration, and we'll go over some practical applications for applying this information in your research or your business. Okay, here we go. The sun powers nearly all forms of life on Earth, either directly or indirectly via the process of photosynthesis. Energy from the sun jumpstarts the process of remixing the components of carbon dioxide and water into useful organic compounds like sugars, starches, and other products containing carbon. We call this remixing process carbon fixation. Photosynthesis consists of three major phases: photolysis, the light-dependent reactions, and the light-independent reactions, aka the Calvin cycle. If you'd like a more detailed review of any of these processes, there's a photosynthesis review video linked in the video description. The Calvin cycle is where we'll focus most of our attention today because that's where C3, C4, and CAM plants really have specialized processes. In the Calvin cycle of photosynthesis, we take carbon from carbon dioxide and we remix its components to make organic molecules. Remember, in the scientific context, organic just means something containing carbon. Carbon dioxide enters the leaf through tiny openings called stomata. The new carbons from that carbon dioxide are added to other carbons that are already in the cycle to make new molecules. The enzyme that does this is called RuBisCO, and it's thought to be the most common protein on Earth. Its full name is ribulose 1,5-bisphosphate carboxylase oxygenase, so you can see why most folks, except maybe its parents, use its nickname. The 1-carbon carbon dioxide combines with a 5-carbon molecule called RuBP, and after a few intermediate steps, it ultimately forms 2 3-carbon molecules called PGA. The PGA combines with a few other key reagents to form PGAL, which is also called GALP in some parts of the world. We then siphon off a couple of them to make into glucose. The remaining PGAL are reinvested into the Calvin cycle to keep it turning. PGA, with its 3 carbons, is why this standard photosynthesis process is called C3. Most plants in the world are C3 plants, but a few common examples include wheat, rice, beans, spinach, fruiting plants, cannabis, and others. The C3 photosynthesis process works very, very well, assuming that there is an ample supply of carbon dioxide available to keep feeding into the Calvin cycle. However, if, for any reason, there isn't enough carbon dioxide to occupy RuBisCO, it's very flexible and it will happily pair up with oxygen instead. That wouldn't be a huge problem, except that obviously oxygen doesn't contain any carbon, and plants need to get carbon from somewhere in order to keep photosynthesizing. Plants do have a workaround where they can slowly recoup carbon to keep the cycle turning, but it's not ideal. This process is called photorespiration, or if you want to get fancy, the oxidative photosynthetic Calvin cycle. The details of all the reactions are outside the scope of this video, and there are about an additional dozen steps that aren't shown here, but the idea is that the plant is able to use 2 additional organelles, peroxisomes and mitochondria, to generate 3-carbon PGA. That new PGA can be fed into the Calvin cycle to keep it going. This process does allow the plant to keep photosynthesizing, but it's maddeningly inefficient compared to the regular Calvin cycle. Even under the best of conditions, it produces 25% less product, it creates a lot more waste in the form of hydrogen peroxide and ammonia, which the plant has to deal with, and it's also energy inefficient because it costs ATP. C3 plants are more likely to do this inefficient photorespiration process when it's hot. This is for 2 reasons. First, in hot weather, C3 plants close their stomata to avoid drying out. And second, because RuBisCO has a greater affinity for oxygen at higher temperatures, new CO2 isn't coming in and eventually the supply will run out. Unfortunately, C3 plants have no special adaptations to avoid photorespiration. If the temperature goes up more than a few degrees, the rate of photosynthesis in C3 plants falls dramatically. Since most food crops are C3 plants, if global temperatures continue to rise, it's likely to have huge implications for food production. While some photorespiration is almost inevitable, it's in a plant's and a grower's best interest to avoid it if at all possible. If crops are only photosynthesizing at 75% capacity, they won't be able to produce nearly as many leaves, flowers, buds, fruits, or seeds. We're now going to begin comparing C3 plants to C4 and CAM plants. C4 and CAM plants are specialists in avoiding photorespiration, and they have a number of mechanisms to help them do it. We'll be keeping track of C3, C4, and CAM photosynthesis processes, leaf structure, example plants, key cells, and the ideal temperature range in a table that looks like this. We've already reviewed the standard C3 photosynthesis process. Carbon dioxide enters through the stomata, it feeds the Calvin cycle, and makes sugars. C4 plants are a bit more crafty. C4 plants thrive in hot environments, and common examples include corn and sugarcane. They have the process of carbon fixation and the Calvin cycle in two different locations. Here's how they do it. In C4 plants, CO2 enters the leaf via the stomata and combines with a 3-carbon product called PEP, or phosphenyl pyruvate. The fixation forms a 4-carbon product called oxaloacetate. The enzyme that does this, PEP carboxylase, will not bind with oxygen in the way that RuBisCO does. Oxaloacetate gets converted into another 4-carbon molecule called malate. This 4-carbon molecule is why the process is called C4. Here's where the plant cells get really smart. The malate gets transported out of the palisade mesophyll cells and into the leaf's bundle sheath cells to power the Calvin cycle. When 4-carbon malate arrives in the bundle sheath cells, it's broken down, forming a 1-carbon carbon dioxide, which RuBisCO can then feed into the Calvin cycle. Because the carbon fixation occurs in one cell and the Calvin cycle occurs in another, RuBisCO never comes into contact with oxygen and the plant can avoid wasteful photorespiration. The 3 leftover carbons are converted into a molecule called pyruvate, which then gets transported back into the palisade mesophyll cells. Finally, this gets converted back into the 3-carbon molecule PEP. This part of the process requires some ATP. The enzyme PEP carboxylase can go to work on the PEP, combine it with the carbon dioxide from the stomata, and the cycle can begin again. The specialized process does cost some ATP, but it still works out in the plant's favor because it avoids the wasteful photorespiration process. Now let's move on to CAM plants. CAM stands for crassulation acid metabolism, and it has many similarities to the C4 pathway. CAM plants live in the desert and include pineapples and succulents like aloe and agave. CAM plants prevent photorespiration by doing their carbon fixation in advance during the nighttime, and then using the products to perform photosynthesis during the day. During the night, the plant can open its stomata without risking drying out, allowing carbon dioxide and some oxygen to diffuse into the leaf. The new molecule, oxaloacetate, gets formed into malate or other organic acids. The plant then stores these acids in vacuoles for use later on. During the day, the plant does have to keep its stomata closed, but it's already stored up the products that it needs. The malate can then be transported out of the vacuoles and then split into pyruvate and carbon dioxide. As in C4, carbon dioxide powers the Calvin cycle, and the pyruvate is reformed into PEP so the cycle can start again. Similar to C4, the specialized process does cost some ATP, but it still works out in the plant's favor because it avoids the wasteful photorespiration process. Now let's talk structure. When we look at the leaf structure of C3, C4, and CAM plants, we can see how their anatomy helps each of them to perform their own version of photosynthesis. Most plants in the world are C3, so they have different variations of this structure on the left. C4 plants have what's called Kranz anatomy, meaning wreath. The palisade mesophyll cells are clustered in a ring around the bundle sheath cells. The two cell types need to be close together because the bundle sheath cells perform part of the C4 photosynthesis process. CAM plants live in the desert, and thus they have to store large amounts of water whenever they have the chance. They tend to store this water in tissue called aquiferous parenchyma, which other plants don't really need. Similar to C4 plants, they have mesophyll cells in wreaths next to the bundle sheath cells, but they tend to have smaller vascular bundles scattered around the perimeter of the leaf rather than a few larger ones. Hopefully now you can fill in the rest of this summary table. We've covered the processes, the leaf structure, example plants, key cells, and the ideal climate for each type of plant. So what does this mean for people trying to grow crops? How can we capitalize on this information? The goal is to maximize the rate of photosynthesis and minimize photorespiration by optimizing the conditions. This might seem obvious, but plants that are struggling to photosynthesize efficiently won't grow as big, will have fewer flowers, and yield less fruit, fewer seeds, and fewer sugars and other useful compounds. Optimizing the conditions will look different depending on which type of plant you're trying to grow, C3, C4, or CAM plants. As we've seen, these plants have different ideal conditions, so it's very hard to grow them all in the same place and still get maximum yield. You're better off separating them or picking one to specialize in. Since C3 plants are the most common, we'll use these as an example, but the conditions can be tweaked to accommodate C4 or CAM plants. Assuming there is ample sunlight and water, the two major factors that control the rate of photosynthesis, i.e. how quickly the plant is able to churn out carbon-rich compounds, are temperature and carbon dioxide saturation. But it's important to understand exactly why. At low temperatures, photosynthesis rate is limited by enzymes, which get too cold to function at full capacity. When the temperature drops, molecules move more slowly, reducing the likelihood of enzyme-substrate collisions. We believe that low temperatures also limit a plant's ability to take up water and nutrients through its roots, even if the temperature never gets below freezing. At ideal temperatures, the available CO2 is the limiting factor. RuBisCO, the enzyme, is not saturated most of the time. In ambient conditions, some of it is standing around without attachment to CO2, and some of it is bound to oxygen. At high temperatures, membranes become deformed and enzymes denature. When membranes deform, ion leakage occurs, gradients don't work as well, the electron transport chain doesn't work well, and the photosynthesis rate decreases. The enzyme that's thought to be by far the most sensitive is NADP glyceraldehyde phosphate reductase. This enzyme is the one that usually converts PGA into PGAL during the Calvin cycle. Without it, production of sugars won't occur. If temperatures fall within the ideal range, adding some CO2 to the local environment can be beneficial and can further boost the rate of photosynthesis. This should be done carefully, however. Carbon dioxide can be expensive, it's not great for the environment, and there are diminishing returns on investment after a certain point. The graph on the right shows the relationship between the rate of photosynthesis and the level of CO2, assuming ideal temperature. Bumping the CO2 level from ambient air concentration of 340 parts per million to about 800 to 900 parts per million gives photosynthesis a boost of almost 20% in ideal conditions. Normal photosynthesis at 340 parts per million assumes some unsaturated or idle RuBisCO. At this 800 to 900 point, RuBisCO is saturated. However, above this point, you'll notice that the curve flattens out, and no matter how much more CO2 you add, the plants don't photosynthesize substantially faster. It should also be noted that letting CO2 levels dip below 340 is more detrimental than boosting CO2 levels above 340 is beneficial. If time or resources are limited, focusing on maintaining ambient levels of CO2 via ventilation is a much better area to focus on than trying to add additional gas. Outdoors, wind can do this for you, and indoors, simply adding a fan to a greenhouse can really help. If you choose to add CO2 to a greenhouse, there's often a window of time when it will do the most good. Adult plants often don't need a constant stream of excess CO2 for their entire lifespan in order to do well. Often, adding CO2 in just the first 2 to 3 weeks as the plants begin to produce buds is the most beneficial for eventual yield. This gives the plant a boost in production of starches and sugars just at the exact moment that it's constructing useful products like flowers, fruits, or seeds. That pretty much wraps up our discussion of C3, C4, and CAM plants, photorespiration, as well as applying this information in a practical way. Thanks again for watching, and please remember to like, comment, and subscribe. See you next time. Bye.